logged in on the webinar. So afterwards, when it comes to Q&A time, we'll ask that everybody use a microphone so that they can hear what the questions are and know what's going on. But we're very happy to have Bill Hayes and Lisa Wilson here from Hayes and Wilson. This is about your fifth time to present for us, and it always comes at a time when parents are very interested in learning this important information. So thank you for being here. Bill, you'll get to kick us off.
Thank you, guys. We usually don't do PowerPoints. We bring along the handouts, and we'll make those available to anybody at home. If you just send us an email to hayeswilsonlaw.com, we will send these papers to you and make those available. I'm Bill Hayes. I'm partner Lisa Wilson. We've been at a law firm about 7.5 years. Our law firm is just at the moment 4 lawyers, 6 paralegals, support staff. All we do is estate planning on the front end, anything from simple wills up to fairly sophisticated tax planning or business succession planning. We do probates, estate administrations, trust administrations. We do a lot of work with special needs, guardianships, special needs situations for children, trying to get all the way on up through adult guardianship. Lisa and I both have a very special interest in this, and we also sit in your chair. My daughter, Emily, some of you may have met, is a voyager here at the Monarch program. Colleen's. Lisa's daughter, Leslie, is Down syndrome and is currently, as of earlier this year, in a group home with Reach Unlimited. And so we both have a very special interest in understanding, and we kind of get it as to some of the issues that you're facing of how do you appropriately provide for your children now, but also how do you put the structures in place for the future. Them as much opportunity to thrive and be independent and gain as much as they possibly can, and yet there's a support system there to help take care of them. We don't do the financial angle of that. You've had a lot of other speakers come to the series that can help you with things like that. We're more into the legal structures, what are the legal tools that we need in order to put the right things in place. And Lisa is really an expert at this. She does far more seminars than I do. And so we're going to let her guide you through this. And you should have two documents. One is on guardianship of your child with special needs, and one is on special needs trust. So Lisa, do you want to dive in and walk them through these things? Thank you.
So I'm going to talk first about guardianship. Typically, there seems to be a lot more interest and a lot more confusion about guardianship when I'm giving similar presentations about both guardianship and special needs planning. So I'm going to talk first about why you might need a guardianship and what it really is, and then secondly, the process of obtaining a guardianship. And then I'll talk about government benefits and why you might need to consider creating a special needs trust. So the threshold question for guardianship is, do you need to obtain guardianship for your child once your child reaches the age of 18? And what a guardianship means is it's a court proceeding where you are appointed as a surrogate decision maker for your adult child. So as we all turn the age of 18, we gain certain rights, the right to vote, drive, get married, decide where we live, contract, enlist in the military. And so if your child who has special needs has these rights, sometimes in making those decisions, they can make decisions that aren't necessarily in their own best interest. So through a guardianship process, you would prove to a court that your child would be at risk if they didn't have you or someone else in position to make these decisions for them. So typically, what prompts my clients to come in and obtain guardianship is considering what might happen in the medical arena. That's probably the most common scenario where people feel compelled to get guardianship of their kids. So you may run into an issue where you're not able to make an appointment for your adult child because the doctor would rather have someone that they're talking to that has authority. And we do see that the medical providers seem to be the entire gamut, in that my clients have said, gee, I've had guardianship for my child for 6 or 8 years. I've never had any issues. And then I do have those clients that come in and say, couldn't make the appointment, couldn't get records sent, couldn't schedule a surgery. With the HIPAA laws, this has become increasingly challenging. So what a guardianship does is it clearly positions you as the primary manager of your adult child's care. A lot of times when you're seeing the same doctor that you've seen with your child turns the age of 18, it may not be an issue at all. It's when you're taking your child to have some procedure that has some risk, a test or a surgery, where the doctor really needs someone who can sign and give informed consent. I worked for a couple of years with a medical malpractice firm, and this was a huge issue that doctors needed to be concerned about. Who can give consent? Who has the legal authority? We've all had those procedures done where you have to sign documents that say this test could result in injury, it could result in death, and that should be a concern from the doctor's perspective. Did the person understand the risks and give consent in light of those risks? And so we typically find that it might be a facility who has a well-established risk management department that may bring everything to a halt if there isn't someone who can give that consent. So the second area that typically would compel people to come in and talk about guardianship would be dealing with entities other than medical providers. And so it might be schools. It might be employers. It might be dealing with government agencies. And that would allow you to continue to advocate for an adult child as you had for your minor child. And then the third area is the rarer but scarier areas where we see kids that are subject to exploitation, basically. And so this is a much more common issue in the higher functioning child. And the whole issue of guardianship is so much more complicated and difficult for the higher functioning child, because you're going to be, as a parent, sort of arguing out of both sides of your mouth that you want your child to be as independent as possible, and everything you do is to position that child to be able to maximize potential. And then out of the other side of your mouth, you're going to be saying, yeah, but you really shouldn't be making these decisions. And so we do see those really extreme cases. They're not common, like I said, rarer but scarier. And I'm always kind of concerned that I sound like I'm scaring into guardianship, and you better come in and hire us, or these terrible things can happen to your child. But we actually do see those things, and I think they really do help illustrate what the issues might be. For example, a client who came in and said her daughter was at home and had always, you know, wanted to be like a typical child. She gets on the internet, she puts out some provocative messages, and next thing you know, she's gone. And mom's calling and calling and calling. Phone's not being answered. Finally, the phone is answered. Mom, stop trying to control my life. I have a boyfriend now. We're at his trailer. And stop bothering me. So mom calls the police. Police go out there. They said, yeah, it looks pretty bad. But she's an adult. She doesn't want to come home. And there's nothing. So a guardianship gives you authority to tell the police, bring my daughter home. Again, that's not everybody's circumstance, but that's the issue. So the lower functioning individual, guardianship is more just putting you in a position where you're managing the care, the mechanics of the care. And for a lot of our clients, their kids you know, the way I put it sort of flippantly is the day before they've had all their constitutional rights removed from them in a court of law is no different than the day after. I mean, really, it has no effect on their lives. But the higher functioning kids, some of them are very aware of what happens when they turn 18. I've had clients say that their kids have luggage packed and perched by the door waiting for the day they turn 18. Where they're going to go, the parents are kind of like, or how they're going to support themselves. Nonetheless, they're really aware of what happens, and that drive to be independent is so profound and so innate that it's a huge issue for, again, those higher functioning kids to talk about guardianship. So we talk often about alternatives for guardianship, and the way I put it is really, if your child needs to be under a guardianship, there isn't really an alternative. There are other things that we could do or adults can do in anticipation of becoming incapacitated. But there's not a whole lot you can do if someone really is to the point where they're limited in their mental capacity and need to be under a guardianship. So powers of attorney are often talked about as alternatives to guardianship, but you really have to have a person who has full mental capacity or pretty high mental capacity. We have often discussed, you know, amongst lawyers that it practically requires a higher level of mental capacity to execute a power of attorney than to execute a will. So the person signing has to fully grasp the powers that they are granting. There's a financial power of attorney, and there's a medical power of attorney. So a financial power of attorney obviously gives someone the right to act on the principal's behalf, behalf relating to financial matters, business matters. And that one can be granted concurrently with the signing, so immediately effective. So I would want my parents to be able to handle anything with my bank or my paycheck. And that would be fine, but again, as long as the person had enough mental capacity to fully grasp those authorities that they were granting. The medical power of attorney is a little bit more difficult because it only becomes effective when the person is determined by their doctor to be incapacitated. So again, you're making a simultaneous but opposing statement that your child had full capacity to execute this medical power of attorney, but I should have authority to act on their behalf because they have a disability. So again, typically they're not really alternatives to guardianship. The other limitation of the power of attorney is not everybody is compelled by law to, no one has to accept a power of attorney. And that generally is more of a problem with financial than medical. The child can revoke it. That's another problem. And maybe a doctor or another individual would have to determine if your child is upset with you and, I don't want you talking to my mom anymore, or I don't want my mom in here. You know, has your child just effectively revoked the power of attorney? So it doesn't give you the same protections that a guardianship would, which would require third parties have to deal with the appointed guardian. So I'm going to talk about the procedure for obtaining a guardianship. I try to get my clients to look at the process through the lens of, you know, the law is written for everybody, and sometimes it makes a little more sense if you think about that it's written for grandma who starts to show some signs of inability to manage her own affairs. Same rules are going to apply to your child. And you also have to look at it through the lens of the law is written to protect the person with the incapacity from having their rights removed unnecessarily. So it does cause the parents to have to jump through a lot of hoops. And it feels very punitive to the parents. They'll come in and they say, we've done everything we can to take care of our child to the best of our ability for 18 years. we, you know, put off things for ourselves. We paid lots of money for therapies, and now we have to prove that we are the best people to take care of our kids. So it is real frustrating, but it's frustrating for the parents. But again, if you think of it, that the law is written for everybody. The law is written to protect you. If you make a couple of bad decisions with your money, that's not enough to allow someone to come in and gain control of your finances. So it's a relatively high burden of proof to prove that someone is incapacitated to the point that they need their rights removed by a court. So it's very different from a lot of other lawsuits in that it has to be a sworn application. So there's a petition that's filed that opens up the case with the court, and it would be a court in the county where the child resides. So it's a petition that has to be sworn to, which is not true in a lot of other lawsuits, but again, just sort of a heightened level of protection that you've got to make sure everything in the application is absolutely correct. The courts have even come back to us and said, you can't say it's true to the best of your knowledge. You have to swear it's true. We start with a doctor's evaluation, and that is a standardized form that the courts have put together, and it has to be based on a recent examination. So basically, the courts want a snapshot of what are your child's immediate and current limitations and abilities. They don't want a school evaluation from several years ago. They want to look right now as we go into this process. What are the issues that your child's dealing with? Right now, the law just requires any physician licensed in Texas. It used to be that we had to have a full IQ test and adaptive behavior evaluation for someone who had an IDD diagnosis, but that's no longer true. They'll take any physician, so it doesn't require a particular specialty. And since typically on a guardianship for an adult child, these are rarely contested issues as far as the incapacity. They might be contested if, like, ex-spouses are fighting over who should be guardian, but they're rarely contested on the issue of disability, so it doesn't require a particular specialty. If we thought we might have to depose a doctor or have some in-court testimony from the doctor, then we want to get a particular specialty. But a lot of times, parents are taking the kid to the pediatrician, even though they're now adults, but the pediatrician is the doctor who's known the kid the longest, and that's fine. And most of the time, those pediatricians don't have any problem doing it. Occasionally, they might say, well, I'm not really certified to do capacity assessments, but that's pretty rare. Most of the time, they'll do that. So an application gets filed with the court, and it has pretty basic information, just that this is the proper county because this is where the child lives. We will make a statement of whether it's a guardianship of the person only or a guardianship of the person and a state. And typically on these types of guardianships, it's guardian of the person only. Most of our kids don't have a state. We really generally don't want them to have a state. One, because that would make them ineligible for any means-tested government benefits that might be out there, which I'll talk about later. And also just because generally there's some limitations in their ability to manage money. And also, a guardianship of the estate is typically something to be avoided because of the level of court involvement and court costs. So typically, again, guardian the person only, which means the guardian gets that authority to decide where the child lives, be the manager of the medical treatment, and again, deal with third parties. And I'm using that term broadly, child or kid. It's a relationship, not minor, so they're adult children and they're contemplating getting guardianship. An application has to list all the immediate family members. And your child has to get served by the sheriff's department. a citation like a regular lawsuit. This is, in fact, a lawsuit. But we typically refer to them as friendly lawsuits because everybody truly is looking out for what's best for the child. Now, again, the heightened level of protection for your child in a lot of other lawsuits, we can get anyone certified over the age of 18 to serve a citation. In a guardianship, it has to be law enforcement. For some reason, that's determined to be extra protection for the child. But again, something that just relates to how the courts look at these cases is they really are concerned about protecting the rights of a person with a disability. We have to notify parents who aren't involved in the proceedings, so if just one parent is applying, we have to notify the other parent. Parents can be co-guardians if they're married or if they're appointed joint managing conservators in the divorce decree. Otherwise, there really isn't a way for co-guardians to serve. So it couldn't be you get appointed and want to also appoint another adult child in case something happens to you. So you and your son or daughter would serve jointly. The courts don't have authority to do that. So the other parent has to get notified, and other adult siblings have to get notified. So again, this is what makes this proceeding so much different from another lawsuit. If you're sued in a regular, you know, you owe somebody money, there's no requirement that the person suing you let all your family members know that they've sued you. But again, protection for the person with the disability, that family members would have a chance to get involved in the case and contest the guardianship or the appointment of the proposed guardian. The court, in most of the counties, will have a requirement where they need to appoint a court investigator. That's certainly true in Harris County, Montgomery County, Galveston. Fort Bend right now does not, but they might. So a court investigator's job is to generally come out, meet with the family, meet with the child, and I see their job as twofold. One, they're going to confirm everything that's in the application. Is this really where the child resides? Is this the proper court where this case should be handled? Is there a need for a guardianship of the estate? So they're going to kind of run through everything that was alleged in the application and make sure it's all accurate and report that back to the court. But the other thing they're doing is they are looking for a less restrictive alternative. And really, almost 100% of the time, if families come in and they're ready to get guardianship, again, it's because it's the appropriate thing to do. There's not typically an alternative if you've got an incapacitated child. But it might be, to illustrate, it might be, you know, if grandma is having trouble keeping her bills straight or taking her medications on time, something like that might be able to be solved by just having someone come in a few times a week, and we don't have to remove grandma's rights and have the court be in control of her assets. So they're looking for alternatives. They have a duty to explore less restrictive alternatives to a guardianship. But almost universally, when it's a parent getting guardianship of a child, the recommendation to the court is going to be that guardianship is necessary and appropriate. So typically after the court investigator's report is filed, then the court appoints a lawyer to represent the child. And this person's job is very different from the court investigator. This person's job is to be your child's voice to the court. So they're going to have to tell them what this means. Like, you might not be able to drive. You were looking forward to driving, but that might not happen. You know, your mom and dad or whoever is going to be the decision maker. So this, again, is your child's opportunity to be heard by the court. A lot of parents get really upset that their child might be against the guardianship, but you have to keep it in perspective. That's just one piece of everything the judge is looking at. The judge is going to be looking at the doctor's report, your testimony and statement, the court investigator's recommendation. But again, your child or the person with the alleged disability has an opportunity to be heard. That's, again, part of their due process rights that they're entitled to through this proceeding. So generally, after all of those pieces come together and all those reports are in front of the court and the proof of notice to all the people that are entitled to be notified, then we would set a hearing. Typically, the hearing is going to be pretty brief because everything, you know, again, everybody is generally on the same page. So each court has a time when they hear uncontested guardianships. You go down there, you might be down there for an hour and a half or so, but your hearing is generally going to be pretty brief, a little bit of testimony in front of the court that kind of tracks what's in the application, that your child's now an adult, he lives in this county, he needs some help taking care of himself, and you're the best person to be appointed to do that. You have to be bonded, which is typically just a minimum thing on a guardianship of the person. A bond makes a lot more sense if you're guardian of someone's estate. Then it's kind of like insuring you that you're not going to take off to Belize with grandma's money. On a guardianship of the person, there's typically just a minimum cash amount that is paid to the court. As guardian, you'd have an ongoing duty once a year to let the court know about the location, condition, and well-being of the child. So it's a pretty minimal requirement. It's a two-page form that the courts put out, and it's a fill-in-the-blank, circle the answer. They basically want to know, where's your child living? Did you have to move him within the past year? If so, why? How's his health? Does the guardianship need to continue? What activities is he involved in? Does he see a doctor regularly? Pretty straightforward. The judges have personal liability to the child once the guardianship is created. They need to take reasonable steps to know that the child is okay, you're still there taking care of them. Again, this is something that seems really intrusive and punitive to the parents, but typically if I describe a couple of circumstances where things have gone really wrong that the courts are made aware of, they kind of see that it actually is good protection for your kid. One example of that is we did have a case where mom was quite elderly and became sick with chronic illness and really was not able to take care of her daughter anymore. And the county got involved and they found a cousin who agreed to be appointed guardian and things got a lot better. But when they first went into the house, it was, you know, kind of like one of the hoarder circumstances where they couldn't open the front door because so much had accumulated and they were living in filth. And this was a family with sufficient means. There was even a court-created special needs trust for the daughter, but mom had lost the ability to care for the daughter. So that's the kind of things. They're not looking to catch you on a bad day or anything like that. In some counties, there is also an annual court visitor. For the same reason, they just want to kind of eyeball, make sure everybody's okay, that you're still there. If you've moved out of the county, they kind of don't want to be responsible anymore because if things go wrong, they don't really have the resources to go out and check and fix things. So they really want to know that you're still there, that your child's still there, you're still able to take care. So the courts, some of the courts use social work students from University of Houston. Some use just volunteers. So they each court has about 1,500 at least guardianships. So that's a lot of annual visits that they have to make, which is why they can't really do it with staff. They just don't have that many people on staff. So again, they just kind of want to go out and eyeball everybody. But I tell my clients that if you're not the case that's raising the red flags, don't be terribly surprised if you're skipped a few years. You know, if your child's living at home and you're sending in your annual reports, they are going out and chasing down the circumstances where there's neglect. And again, if you sit in the guardianship courts for any length of time, you really hear some hair-raising stories. So they're very, very busy protecting their wards. About it on guardianship. Does anybody have a question? Yeah. So there's a statute that says if you are the parent and the court-appointed guardian, you get to designate the successor. And we've taken the position that even if you're not, if you haven't gotten guardianship yet or whatever, or somebody else is perhaps serving, you know, an ex-spouse, you can still take the opportunity to designate a successor. So you would do that through, typically it's done through part of your estate plan, but a lot of our clients, if we're doing guardianship, as we wrap up, we do a designation of successor and go ahead and file it in the case. So if something happens, it's right there in the court's file of who you want the successor to be. They still have to apply to the court to be appointed, but they don't have to go through this entire process of proving the need. You've established that there's a need for a guardianship, then it's only up to the court who's the best person. So if you're the parent and the court-appointed guardian, whoever you've named is presumed best. So if that person that you've named applies and another person applies, it's like really no question in front of the court. It's going to be the person that you've named is already presumed to be better, unless they've just committed some heinous crime, because ultimately it's up to the court to determine who would be the right person, considering the best interest of the ward of the child. There are a lot of myths about guardianship, so I just want to talk about that real quick, because there's a lot of bad information out there that people come in and they don't want to get guardianship because, and they'll say something that's not really true. So one of those is that the parents presume that if they get guardianship, they will extend their financial responsibility to their child. So, you know, our financial responsibility to our children ends when they turn age 18. But the guardianship does not do that. It's still, or your child still would be eligible for any means-tested government benefits, whether you have guardianship or not. I've only run across one circumstance where a guardianship really bumped up against a child getting the best benefit, and that is under the Medicaid waiver programs. If you've heard of those, CLASS and HCS, you can choose a consumer-directed service option, which instead of going to a provider, a company that has gotten certified to provide services through HCS or CLASS, the child, basically the consumer, as he or she would be referred to, is the employer or the director of the services, consumer-directed service option. So if a parent is a guardian, they basically are stepping in the shoes of the child as the consumer. So under these programs, you can't be both the guardian and the paid caregiver. Now, under typical HCS and CLASS, a parent who is a guardian can be the paid caregiver. It's just if you choose the consumer-directed service option, which again means you don't necessarily go through another provider, but the consumer, the person with the disability, receives the funds directly to pay caregivers or pay for other services. So you don't have to really fully comprehend that right now, but just maybe that seed in the back of your mind that when you're making that decision on consumer-directed, if that's an issue. But generally, guardianship does not hinder or otherwise make your child ineligible for services. It really, you know, comes down to a matter of who signs the forms and who's able to communicate with the providers. There is no benefit to getting a guardianship before a child turns 18. For some reason, this myth has perpetuated a long time that people come in, or at least call, way before a child turns 18 and says, well, I want to get it before he's 18 because I heard it's a much simpler process and you don't have to get the court-appointed attorney. And that's totally not true. It never has been true, but for some reason that is information is still out there. So we can now start the guardianship process once the child is within 18 months 6 months of the 18th birthday. It used to be that you couldn't start until they were 18, then it was 60 days before, now it's 6 months. So that's great, because that gives us a lot of time to be ready to go by the 18th birthday. It typically doesn't take that long, but that's a really good time to be thinking about it and starting to move forward on it, considering getting the doctor's evaluation. There's also no detriment if you don't get it at 18. A lot of people are terrified that they'll wait too long, and generally that's not an issue. A couple times a judge may ask, why did you wait till they're 35? You know, what's different now that hasn't been an issue for the last 17 years? And sometimes it truly is that something has come up and we need to get a guardianship in place. Typically the process is going to take between 3 and 4 months. So it is something that you want to plan on, because getting guardianship in a crisis is not easy to do. The courts are really reluctant to do an emergency or temporary guardianship. They'll ask the question, well, didn't you know that this could happen? The cost basically doubles, because you do a temporary guardianship, which is good for 60 days, and then you have to then repeat the process to get a permanent guardianship. So it's not easy to do. To me, there's no downside to getting a guardianship. You know, if in fact your child has a condition that would warrant a guardianship, there typically is no downside. I know a lot of my clients get really emotional about it. They don't want to take away their kids' rights. And I get that, but again, it's like they're still going to let you know what they want to have for breakfast the next morning and what movie they want to see on the weekend, and a reasonable guardian is not going to say, well, now all the decisions are up to me. It's just, you know, they're not going to have the capacity to sign documents, and again, you'll still be positioned as the one in control and managing their care and education and that kind of thing. Any other questions about guardianship? So it's pretty easy to transfer to another state or to transfer a guardianship from another state. There is a uniform code that a lot of states have adopted. Texas has not, but our law pretty much sounds exactly like the uniform code. So it's pretty easy to do. We typically have to get someone in that other state. You do a motion to transfer, and then you get certified copies of the entire file and send it to the new court. Pretty easy to do. Within the state, it's even easier, very easy to transfer one from county to county. And generally, the courts want you to do that because, again, they're personally responsible for the ward under a guardianship, so they don't want somebody that's too far away, but they really don't have the resources to check on. Good question. So the first was what the cost was, and the second was whether it was permanent unless revoked. So our firm is probably pretty average, middle of the road, and I tell people it's going to be about $3,500 to $4,000 to do the whole thing. We charge a $2,500 fixed fee for our fees. You generally are going to also have to pay the court-appointed attorney fee for the attorney that's appointed to represent your child. Usually in the ballpark of $500 to $1,000, but it's, you know, it's hard to say. We don't know who that person's going to be and what their rates are and how much time they spend on the case. And then there's about $400 in court costs, the filing fee and the process server. So generally, a guardianship is permanent. Now, if you don't file those annual reports, you can be removed as a guardian. You need to file them. If you don't file them, the court will send you a nasty letter and say, you know, you got 2 more weeks and you better get it in, and if you don't, then you'll be served with a citation and you have to go down to court and explain why you shouldn't be removed. It drives the courts crazy because they say, how can we not wonder about what's happening with the kid when they can't fill out this page and a half form? And it gets sent in with a $13 filing fee, so it's not terribly burdensome. You don't have to go to court, you don't have to hire an attorney. If you don't file it, you could be removed and the court would have But the rest of your question about you can't revoke a guardianship. You just can't unilaterally say, well, he doesn't need to be under a guardianship anymore. We're not going to do this anymore. You really have to go through the entire process again in reverse. You get a doctor's letter that says the person can be totally or partially restored to capacity, file the application. Court investigator generally is going to get involved. The court would appoint an attorney to represent the child, so you are going through the whole thing again, which is great. If someone can be restored, that's wonderful. We have done a couple of partial restorations specifically to driving. Driving is a really, really difficult issue. When we file an application for guardianship, we have to file, we have to state in the application the order whether we're taking away the right to vote and the right to drive, because these get immediately reported to the licensing and registering bureaus of the state. And parents a lot of times will want the child to retain the right to drive, saying, well, not now, but you know, maybe in the future we'd like him to be able to drive. And the courts are like, no, we got a doctor's letter right now. Can your child get behind the wheel of the car right now and safely operate the vehicle? And the courts are really concerned about everybody having liability if we let someone drive who has no business being on the road. And we've had clients who will train their kids on the exact route of driving tests so that they pass. But really, should they be out on the road with their limited abilities? So I know I got off track here talking about driving, so I'll go back to can do a restoration, but it is more involved, again, partial and full restoration. But I do want to talk a little bit more about the driving, because it is just a huge issue for clients. So we have a lot of it depends on the judge, and you don't know and you can't pick your judge. So I've had one judge look at a doctor's report, and it said that, you know, the child can't reason logically, can't break down complex tasks into small steps, has, you know, blah, 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 but he can safely operate a motor vehicle, and the judge kind of chuckled and shrugged and said, okay. And we've had other judges that we've gone back with the record from the driving school saying this person, you know, has spent a lot of time in the car with the child, and the child absolutely can drive and makes good judgment, and the judge is like, nope, not doing it. So you have to be prepared in moving forward with the guardianship process that your child might not retain a right to drive. We have kids who have been driving, and we've had kids who have been driving and been in a lot of wrecks, and we've had kids who have been driving and have not been in wrecks. And, you know, again, they're at risk of having their licenses taken away through the guardianship process. So that's a really tough issue for a lot of families. Marriage is a huge issue, too. And personally, I don't see how it's feasible that a person under a guardianship can be married. But courts have done it, and other attorneys don't seem to have a problem with it. So what I generally tell my clients is if that really becomes an issue, we can go back to court. But a lot of times when they first come in and are talking about guardianship and talking about marriage, there is no prospective bride or groom. They're not in that kind of relationship. It's just thinking about the future. And it concerns me that the parents are too worried about a remote possibility in the future than the protections that the guardianship would give their child at the time immediately. So that has to be weighed too. Well, the way I look at it, I think courts look at it differently. The way I look at it is it's such a personal decision that, you know, what I always say flippantly is we've all married people our parents didn't approve of. So why should the parent or a guardian, you know, it's just such a fundamentally personal decision, a marriage. But the alternative is you have a guardianship where you accept out the right to marry, then your child, well, you don't want that either, because then it means without your permission. And again, you have a difficult argument from the court. What is the single most important decision anybody makes? And we've said this person is incapacitated in every other area of their life, but we're going to let them make that decision. Now, I guess you could argue that you could always annul a marriage if a person's incapacitated. So, but again, it comes up so rare. I mean, we see the articles in the magazine, we see the stories on TV where a couple with a disability gets married, but it's actually never actually come up in a case. And I'm sure we've done over 1,000 guardianships, but to me that just seems like something we don't want to set up in society, where a guardian can marry off incapacitated people, whether you think it's a great idea or not. There's just something that is bothersome about that. Now, the way a lot of courts look at that is you basically do, but they want to be involved as far as filling out which rights are there. So I think a lot of it would depend on the court. There isn't anything clear out there. But again, a lot of people don't seem to have a problem with it. But going down back to court and doing almost like a prenuptial agreement. Marriage does affect benefits really fundamentally too. So that's another problem, is people need to be aware of that, that your child might be entitled to lifetime benefits based on your contribution to Social Security, but that would go away if they get married. And you reminded me of something else. Let's see if I can recall it to my mind. Okay. Anything else on guardianship? Yeah. Well, I think the driving is just different in that, you know, it potentially puts people at risk. So, for example, the voting, nobody really has a problem with that. But the other retained rights, you know, it is, the other retained rights, when we've done them, have really been, it was a big deal when our statute changed to allow for partial guardianship. But practically, you know, the big important decisions, like allowing your child to contract or sign up for the military or marriage, those really are the things that you would want to maintain control of, basically. So when we've done a partial guardianship, most of the time when we're doing a partial guardianship, it's when the board has a mental illness. So they really can function pretty well, and then they might have just episodes of incapacity. And when we've done a partial guardianship in those cases, we still leave the guardian with the ultimate authority, but we'll work out, well, the ward has the right to be present at any meetings where his academic programming is discussed, or has the right to be involved and present at any meeting where his treatment is being discussed. And so they're kind of like things that a reasonable parent would do anyway, but sometimes it just helps us work through that process if the person is really opposed to being under a guardianship. But typically, it is kind of an all or nothing, because, again, you're really only talking about those core issues that the person would be at risk, and that generally is what's prompting you to get the guardianship in the first place. And it's hard to find those areas that you can carve out an exception. You know, persons, I'm going to say this, but I know you can make an argument, you know, generally if they're limited in their cognitive abilities, it is more often across the board. And so it's hard to carve out that they would have the ability to do this task as a typical adult would. Yeah. That should be fine. I've never heard of any. Oh, I'm sorry. So the question is, if you are here on a green card as a legal resident, that there wouldn't be any detriment, I mean, any hindrance to you serving as guardian for adult child. So. And that's not a problem. Okay, I'm going to move over and talk about special needs trusts now. And so, to me, it always makes more sense to start this discussion by talking about the benefits, and because eligibility for the benefits is what compels the need for the special needs trust. So there's two major tracks of benefits. There's the benefits that are available through Social Security Administration, and there are the benefits that are available through state-administered Medicaid. So the benefits that come through Social Security Administration, most kids will first access that system when they turn 18, and because at that age, parents' income and parents' assets are no longer considered when determining eligibility. So most kids, again, access at age 18, and the benefit that they usually come into first is SSI, Supplemental Security Income. It supplements a person's monthly income up to a maximum amount, which this year is $733 a month. So the eligibility criteria are that the person has to be a citizen or a legal resident. They have to meet Social Security's definition of a qualifying disability, which is basically the inability to earn more than about $1,050, I think it's $1,040 a month this year. So if it's a younger person that doesn't have a work history, then they look at functional limitations. Could this person work and earn this minimum amount? They'll look at assets, which can't be cumulative over $2,000 with some exclusions, most of which don't apply to our kids. And then they have to have limited monthly income, because again, the SSI is a supplement to the monthly income up to $733. So if they have countable income over that, they're not going to be eligible. They have categories of income as earned income and unearned income. So unearned would be, you know, if grandma gets them $100 a month, they count that as unearned income, and they would get $633 a month instead of $733 a month. If they're earning it, then there's some exclusions that can be taken from the wages, and less is counted. So, you know, generally if somebody's earning $800 a month, it might be that it only ends up being about 360 in countable income. The other thing that they consider income is the benefit that someone may be providing to the child in the way of paying for household expenses. So most kids living at home are going to get a reduced benefit because they take into consideration the benefit that the parents are providing by paying for groceries and housing. So again, this is where most kids get in the system at age 18. And it's important to get them in the system early, because if they get that, if they get that disability determination prior to age 22, then they fall into this category of disabled adult child. And let me make it clear, they don't have to necessarily get the determination before they're age 22, but the determination has to be made that they were disabled before age 22. So that determination could be made later, but it certainly is much easier if they deny that you can go back and get current medicals to establish that the disability manifested before age 22. So the SSI also provides Medicaid. Medicaid comes along automatic with an SSI eligibility determination. And for most clients, this is not that big of an issue, because they typically are carried on parents' private medical insurance. But because they're eligible for Medicaid, Medicaid likes to be positioned where the child stays on the private insurance. So they will do a cost-benefit analysis and determine whether it's better for them to reimburse you for the cost of the private insurance to make sure the family stays on the private medical, or carry the sole cost of monthly cost of the child's medical. So generally, I don't really know what their cutoff is, but you know, if you're paying $350 a month out of your paycheck to cover yourself and the child or family on private insurance, they probably would pay that. If you're paying $1,600 a month, then they probably want to look at the child's medical over the past 12 months and make a determination of whether they should pay the private insurance or just pay for the child's medical bills. So typically, again, that's where our kids are going to start in the system. If they're determined to be a disabled adult child of someone, a parent who has contributed to Social Security, then when there's a triggering event in the parent's life, the child becomes eligible for benefits. So if a parent retires and starts to draw down Social Security, then the disabled adult child who has the eligibility and qualifying disability will also get a benefit at that time, and it'll be 50% of whatever the parent's check is. So this might put the child in the position where they're now getting two checks. So if a parent retires and the parent's getting $800 a month Social Security benefits, the child would get $400 a month. Well, if the child had been getting $600 a month from SSI, again, that's a supplement, they would get the $400 a month from regular Social Security, and now their check would be reduced to $200 from SSI, the supplement up to wherever they should be. If they were getting the full $733, they'd get a check for $333 from SSI. After 24 months on the regular Social Security, the child would become eligible for Medicare. If the second parent retires later and they're getting $2,000 a month or $3,000 a month, the child will default to the higher record of the parents. So if a parent, another parent retires and is getting $3,000 a month, the child now gets $1,500 a month. So now they're clearly above the 733. They're no longer eligible for the SSI and that automatic Medicaid. They're on regular government benefits, regular Social Security benefits and Medicare. And the regular Social Security and the Medicare are entitlement benefits. So they are not based on financial need. They're not contingent on the assets or income. When a parent dies, the child's eligibility is 75% of what the parent's benefit was. So this is huge. I mean, that's for the child's lifetime. So it's an enormous benefit that can help contribute to the long-term care needs of the child. So it's really important to be aware of that system and find out about the rules and explore eligibility for your child. So again, your child moves from SSI Medicaid to regular entitlement benefits in Medicare. They can generally keep the Medicaid a number of ways. There is a particular provision under the rules that allows for the continued Medicaid in that precise circumstance. If the only reason the child lost it is because they became no longer eligible for the SSI and automatic Medicaid because of monthly income based on a parent's contribution, they can reapply and continue the Medicaid. So again, you're moving your child from SSI, private insurance, Medicaid, to maybe some combination of those if one parent retires and one's still working, and then ultimately to full disabled child benefits and Medicare and Medicaid. So, you know, essentially once they're in the system, their basic medical would be covered for life. The other track of programs that are significant are the Medicaid, the state-administered Medicaid programs. And so these fall under the umbrella term of Medicaid waiver programs, which is kind of a confusing term, but it means that Medicaid is allowed by federal funding source to waive some of the stricter Medicaid requirements in order to serve targeted populations. So there's five Medicaid waiver programs. There's a medically dependent children program for kids who need skilled nursing, basically. They need nursing type care because of their health care needs. There is the deaf, blind, multi-disability waiver program. There is community-based alternative, which is for someone who would normally need a nursing home setting, but it provides those same services in the home. There's home and community-based services. This is generally for a person that either has an IDD, you know, what we used to call MR, mental retardation diagnosis, and now it's intellectual developmental disability. The HDS is for that population, or for individuals who have a low IQ and another disabling condition. So that might mean someone who doesn't necessarily meet the requirements, the eligibility of an IDD, but they have an IQ between 70 and 75 and have autism or other diagnosis. And then there's CLASS, and HDS, by the way, stands for Home and Community-Based Services, and CLASS is Community Living Assistance and Support Services. So CLASS is for individuals who don't meet the criteria for the MR or low IQ, but they have other disabling conditions that are considered developmental. So this wouldn't be the person who suffers a head trauma at the age of 40 or something like that. It would have to be someone who has, again, something that generally manifested during the developmental years. These programs provide tremendous benefit to families. And the history of them is that they, you know, we look back to what started them generally was lawsuits. It was a group of plaintiffs with mental illnesses that would only be receiving services once they were institutionalized in mental health hospitals. And so their lawsuit was, couldn't we get some of this assistance in the community so we didn't have to be institutionalized? And so it was part of the general deinstitutionalization trend. And so the philosophy of the programs is to support families to allow the person with the disability to stay integrated in the community. And it is real interesting because, you know, they honestly try to live up to that philosophy. And so they will provide services in the home. And even HCS is the one that also provides residential, you know, provides homes for residential care in typical neighborhood homes. They can't have more than three, maybe four residents in typical neighborhoods. So they're not trying to recreate an institutional setting. It's more like, you know, typical people living in a typical neighborhood. So these benefits are arguably more significant once your child ages out of a school system where there's no obligation for anyone to provide services for your child at that point, but these programs can provide funding for therapies and paying, again, a family member for as caregiver or other person as a caregiver. There's some nursing and behavior and home devices and adaptive aids, so funding for all kinds of things. I think HCS, the maximum funding a person can receive during the year is around $175,000. Most individuals aren't getting that. Most of them, it'll be more around the $40,000 range. But again, just a huge, huge benefit. You know, if you're looking at someone who needs lifetime care needs and has a typical life expectancy, that's a lot of care that needs to be provided. They are, again, Medicaid, so they are need-based benefits. For a lot of families, this is important, even families with significant resources because of the high cost of long-term care needs. And the infrastructure that's out there is really the Medicaid. I mean, there's some awesome programs like Monarch, but they're not that many that really address the needs of the individuals in adulthood. There's not a lot out there in private pay. There's not a lot. There's really nothing I know of that's like sliding scale that would address a family. I guess there is. There's a couple that will determine a family's eligibility to pay, but there's not a lot out there. And you know, for a lot of my clients, they have kids that might have real unusual behavior issues where they don't really have a choice of placements. And so these programs are out there as a safety net to provide the long-term care services for their kids. So that's what compels doing estate planning and setting up the special needs trust. So the special needs trust is a trust that is drafted in a way that any assets in the trust are not going to be counted when eligibility is determined for the child. And so your trustee's job is to then make sure that any disbursements from the trust are also not going to cause the child's ineligibility. Generally, the Medicaid programs are going to look at, I think I got off track, I said the citizenship or legal status, disabling condition, assets, and monthly income. So the trust is to address the assets, also should address monthly income. So a trust is really, it's an agreement where you as the grantor, the person who would be directing assets into the trust, you've designated a trustee and you want your trustee to agree to take on this job, and the trust agreement is basically the terms by which they agree to adhere, and they're going to hold assets, administer them, make them available to your child according to the terms of the agreement. And it's an enormous undertaking, and the person or entity that you name for this job really needs to be aware of the enormity of the undertaking. A trustee, what they should do is at the time they accept the job and the trust is funded, there are assets to be administered, they should call together relevant people, your child, if there's a guardian, if there's other family members, if there's caregivers, if there's residential people, if there's education people, if there's job coaching, and determine what is this, medical providers as well, you know, what is this child's life expectancy, what's their ability to contribute to their own care needs, what are their care needs, what are their future health needs anticipated to be, what's the best residential circumstance. So having this, the trustee's job really is to coordinate that and manage these funds so that the immediate needs of the beneficiary are being met and also the long-term care needs, so it's there for their lifetime. Typically, we set these up that they become funded at the death of the parent. There are some circumstances that would be funded before then, but generally, for most of our clients, it's part of their will plan, and you would say, you know, in the event of my death, everything to my spouse. If my spouse is also deceased, everything to my children equally, but the part that would be allocated to my daughter, Leslie, will not go to her, but will instead go over to the special needs trust that we've set up for her benefit. You can name an individual as a trustee. You can name a bank or a trust company as a trustee. And we also have an option, a nonprofit pooled trust. So there's not the right answer on who you should name as a trustee. Everybody's circumstance is going to be different. An individual can be the best choice if there's someone in your family that you absolutely trust. But you also have to anticipate something happening in their lives that they might not be able to take on that responsibility. You have to be fully aware of the risks in naming a person. There's nobody that's going to be policing that person generally in their role as trustee. They are on their own. Now, ultimately, beneficiaries can sue, but again, nobody generally is monitoring them along the way, unless you specifically set that up and have someone else as a monitor. But that's, again, sometimes a good plan, but you've got to think about the people you're considering, their abilities, their own diligence and organization. We have seen the worst happen with some individuals serving as trustees. The worst probably I've seen personally was when someone called and said, gee, my brother is threatening to sue me because I'm trustee for my niece, the daughter of my other brother, and sure, we borrowed a little from it when my wife and I were having some trouble to pay our mortgage, and I did lend my other brother some money, and then he lost his job and his truck broke, so I had to help him buy a new truck so that he could get a new job. And what did I do wrong? And I said, well, let's look at your trust agreement. And he said, I don't think I have one. And so he had no idea what he was doing. I mean, that's really kind of extreme. But we have seen people borrow. We've seen people have really good intentions but not really know what they're doing and suddenly get the trust into a big tax trap because they didn't get appropriate advice on investments. We've seen family members who've always held a grudge against their sibling with a disability, and when they became the trustee, they undid parents' plans, saying, well, it's, you know, basically it's my turn now. She always got all the attention. So you really, really have to put a lot of thought into who the trustee is. So a corporate trustee is another option. The good part there, the positives of a corporate trustee is that they understand fiduciary responsibility. They are audited. They aren't going to be tempted to borrow a little this month to pay back next month. But the downside of the corporate trustee is that if you're not the big trust, you might not get the attention. And unfortunately, we've seen that an awful lot of times, that the clients are very unhappy about not getting getting things returned. I'm involved in one trust right now, and I visited with the beneficiary, and she said she was so terrified of her trust officer that she hadn't asked for anything for months. And so I asked for her. She wanted some clothes and a computer. And so I asked about 4 months later of the trustee, did we ever get that for her? Well, we've been real busy with tax season. I'm like, that's 4 months that your beneficiary is. She's in a wheelchair. She has a trach. She can't. Her computer is her access to the world. And they were too busy because it was tax season. You know, it's just atrocious, I think. So when we do name a corporate trustee, we often put in a trust protector, a family member that can have the ability to fire them. And so, but naming that person is tricky too, because you want them to really delve into it and not be too reactionary. We have a lot of clients that come in and complain about their trust officer if they have a corporate trustee. And when we sit down with prospective new trustees at different companies that say, you know, we would have handled that exactly the same way. So sometimes it's just the expectation of how a trustee is going to operate. The Pool Trust is a nonprofit organization that is set up to manage separate accounts for the benefit of the person with the disability, but the assets are all pooled for investment purposes. So we most often, I personally have only used the Arc of Texas Master Pool Trust because I've found them to be so user-friendly and low-cost. And so the benefit of something like a pool trust is you get professional management of the funds. With the Arc Pool Trust, JP Morgan Chase does all the investments. They have pretty much separated out the roles of trust, the jobs of trustee into two different entities handling it. So JP Morgan Chase does all the investment tax reporting, and then the ARC, which, if you're not familiar with the ARC, it's a disability advocacy organization. There's a national ARC that's been around for 60 or 75 years or something. There's state ARCs, there's local ARCs. So the state ARC, the ARC of Texas, manages this pool fund. Again, we found them to be great to deal with. They're getting bigger all the time, so they'll probably reach that critical mass when they're no longer as accessible as they have been. But they have, any question we've asked them, they have probably worked out the mechanics of making that distribution work. And so I think that that's a great benefit to the clients. Want to take the beneficiary on a trip? How do we do that? How do we pay for that? How do we get reimbursed from the trust? They've worked all that out. The trusts are, they have running dialogue with Medicaid and Social Security, so we know it's going to be, the trust itself is pre-approved, so all of that is good. The downside to the ARC is it's somebody sitting at a desk in Austin that's going to look at faxed disbursement requests and make a determination of whether they run afoul of the Medicaid or SSI rules and then say yes or no. So they're generally not there for the long-term planning. They'll probably never meet your kid. So, you know, in some circumstances, that might be great. If at the time it's being set up, your person's real stable in the residential situation, you have a, you know, good grasp of what their needs are. I think it works especially well if you have a really capable individual who can make their own requests and deal directly, or if you have a guardian. Because then it should be the guardian's job maybe to make sure, boy, if we keep taking these quarterly trips to Disney World, there might not be enough money, you know, in the long haul. So, again, just kind of thinking through what's good in your particular circumstance and who the pool of people is in your family and friends circle that you can pull on to serve in these various roles. So any questions about benefits or trust? Okay. So the term special needs trust is kind of a broad umbrella term that means a trust that is established with the intent that the assets in the trust are not going to be countable for purposes of determining the person's eligibility for benefits. But there are, broadly, there's two types. A self-funded, that would be the person with the disability, their money going into the trust, and then a third-party funded. So third-party funded is generally what we're doing when we're setting up parents' estate plan. We're going to set up a will. Again, everything is with my kids, but Leslie's share goes over into this trust. That way, assets from my estate or my husband's estate go directly into the trust. They do not go to Leslie first. So if well-intentioned great aunt, which is the case we had, well, I have this great nephew, he has Down syndrome, I'm just going to leave him $50,000 in my will. So if the child is named as a beneficiary in the will, that's the child has legal title, legal right to that property at the moment of the aunt's death. So that type of trust. So your choices when a child comes into money, and these families are typically families who will say, gee, we never thought we'd be unhappy to get $50,000, but it's really going to screw up our child's benefits. We finally found a residential placement that's working, and now that's all going to be blown out of the water. So your solution to child who's on benefits coming into assets are basically two choices. You either spend it down and get them positioned again so they're financially eligible, or you can put it into an exclusion trust. So if the clients call and they say they got $7,000, we'll look for a way to spend that down, because creating a self-funded trust is expensive. You can spend $2,000 or $3,000 or more doing that. So if it's a relatively small amount, we'll look for a way to spend it down. One of the cases I have right now is a case where the child got $110,000 from Social Security, saying that they should have been paying the kid based on dad's contributions after dad retired for years, and they were still paying the kid SSI and realized they should have been paying dad's benefits. So they got $110,000. So obviously that's challenging to spend down in a few months to get the child back on benefits. So we're creating a self-funded trust. The challenges on the self-funded trust is there's only certain ways you can create it. A parent can create it. A grandparent can create it. A guardian can create it. Or a court can create it. And usually we have one of those things, but not always. The big catch with the self-funded trust is that it has to provide that when the child dies, anything remaining in the trust goes back to Medicaid. So that's the deal Medicaid makes. If you're on benefits or anticipating getting on benefits and you come into some assets, they'll allow you to set it aside, stay on benefits, or become eligible, but they get to collect what's left up to the amount they have paid out in benefits during the child's lifetime. And that means that if your child, if the trust is set up and your child dies the next month, they still have the right to collect from all the way back of when the child first got on Medicaid, not just necessarily from the date of the trust. So that's the bad result of not planning and not informing other family members about the need to leave any gifts for the child into a trust. So what we typically do is when we sign off with a parent's estate plan that has a special needs trust, is we do a letter to the family that they can then use as a way to bring up the topic with grandparents, aunts, and uncles. Just, you know, if this ever crossed your mind, here's a letter from our lawyer that talks about how important it is to make sure it doesn't result in an outright gift. And just another thing that I want to mention, the waiver programs that I talked about have significant waiting lists. And so this is what traumatizes a lot of my families. When they've waited 10, 11, 12 years to get their child these services through the Medicaid waiver programs, and then their child gets this inadvertent inheritance, and they panic that they have to go back to the end of a 12-year wait list. So usually we are creating these self-funded trusts through that inadvertent inheritance or unknown inheritance, or the back benefits on Social Security. And what I'm afraid of with this one client, because I've seen it happen too, is they've determined that they've underpaid this person for several years, but then they also may determine a few years from now that their calculations were off, and then they would send an invoice for $30,000. That we've seen now, it's like it takes them several years to kind of catch up with things. So we've seen that a lot. And then lawsuits. So sometimes the lawsuit is related to the incident that caused the disability, or sometimes it's just someone with a disability is involved in a car accident or something, and there's a settlement made directly to the person for their injuries, and so we need to get that put into a self-settled trust. Any questions? So a typical corporate trustee, what we've seen is 1%. The highest I've seen is 1.35%. And that's annually of the assets under management. And some trustees will handle real estate and some won't. So that's another thing you'd want to look at as you're selecting a trustee, whether you intend that your house would be a trust asset, allowing your child to remain in the house. The ARC, for example, will only take cash, so everything would have to be liquidated and sent to the ARC to be set up in a pool trust account. Okay, so following up, if you have any questions, you can email, you can go to our website and email any of us, but the website is hayeswilsonlaw.com, and my address is lisa@hayeswilsonlaw.com, bill@hayeswilsonlaw.com, and we'd welcome your questions. Thanks very much.